Hello, my name is Mariana with the Pajarito Environmental Education Center, and today I want to talk about something that humans have in common with a lot of the animals that live around us, which are the five senses. Do you know the five senses? They are smell, sight, hearing, taste, and touch. Wild animals use their senses on a daily and nightly basis for survival. Having an excellent sense of smell, for example, is an adaptation that helps an animal to succeed in finding food. An adaptation is a specific trait that an animal has evolved to help it better survive in its environment, to give it an advantage. Let's look at this bear skull. This is a black bear. Bears are famous for having an excellent sense of smell. Let's look at this nose. It's a very long nose, as you can see, and there's also a very big hole right here. We call this the nasal cavity. A cavity is a hole, and inside the bear's nasal cavity is a maze of webbing, very complex maze of webbing. These are many sheets of bone, and the more complex this maze of webbing is, the better this animal can pick up smells in its environment. So as well as this long nose and this big hole, the bear has a very complex maze of webbing. This tells us that this animal has an excellent sense of smell. Bears are omnivores, which means they eat meat as well as plants. Most of their diet consists of plant material. So a bear needs to have an excellent sense of smell in order to find the best berries and the best acorns, because bears cover a lot of ground in the woods and fields, so they need that great sense of smell to find their food. If you were outside and you needed to smell a flower, you would probably get really close to it and take a big sniff. Well, a bear doesn't have to get that close. A bear can smell that flower from many, many, many feet away, because of their excellent sense of smell. Let's look at another animal here. This is a bobcat. And if we align the bobcat and the bear's eyes, eye to eye, you can see here that the bobcat has a much smaller nose than the bear does in comparison. So not only is her nose much shorter, kind of like your cat at home, if you have one at home, they have a really short nose. She also has a very small nasal cavity. Remember this hole? And there's not much webbing in there, not a lot of webbing in there like on the bear. So you can see from those signs that this animal doesn't have as good a sense of smell. It's not that the bobcat can't smell, of course. She just doesn't depend on her sense of smell as much as the bear does to find her food. So we'll put the bear aside for a moment. So how does a bobcat find her food? Well, bobcats are predators. They are carnivores, which means they only eat meat, as you can see from these sharp teeth. They like to hunt at dawn and dusk and well into the night. We call that nocturnal behavior, moving around and hunting at night. And in the night, in the dark, the bobcat likes to sit and wait for her prey, which could be, for example, a rabbit. So she'll sit and wait, and she'll listen for her prey. She'll listen as the rabbit comes closer and closer, and she'll wait for the right moment to pounce on that animal to catch her. Now, you can't see the ears on this skull, can you? You need skin and tissue and fur to see the outer ears. So how can we determine, based on this skull, how well this animal can hear? Well, just like humans, bobcats have what we call an inner ear. So if you look at these two bubbles here, we call these auditory bullae, or auditory pockets or bubbles. They're very round and bulbous, so they're very clearly visible here. These are hollow pockets, and they contain the inner ear. Auditory means sound. So these are sound pockets, and they receive sounds from their environment. The bigger these bubbles are, especially in comparison to the size of the skull, and the more visible they are, the better this animal can hear. Now, for example, as a comparison, I'll show you the bear. Now, these are the sound pockets or auditory bullae on the bear. They're not very round, they're not very visible, they're kind of hard to detect at first. That's because the bear does not use her sense of hearing as much as the bobcat can. It's not that the bear can't hear, right? They can hear pretty well, but not as well as a bobcat can. So you can see from these bubbles, very excellent hearing. Now, if you were standing outside in nature and you were listening to the birds and you closed your eyes, it would be hard for a human to know exactly how many birds are around you, or even exactly how many feet away a bird might be if your eyes are closed. Well, with her excellent sense of hearing, the bobcat can tell how many birds are around, and how far away they are from her. There's something else pretty remarkable about this skull that I want to talk about, and those are her eyes. Now, a bobcat has forward-facing eyes, and I'm going to use these buttons to demonstrate where her eyes are on this skull. And they're right here at the front, and this is how they face, forward. Kind of like a pair of binoculars. And having these forward-facing eyes helps the bobcat to measure things like distance really well, so that when she's chasing and leaping after prey and pouncing on them, she knows exactly how far she needs to leap to catch that animal. This gives her a really great advantage, having these forward-facing eyes. So for the prey animal, how does a prey animal compensate? What kind of adaptation might a prey animal have to help it escape from such an excellent predator? Well, here's another skull. It's a little smaller. This is a prairie dog. And the prairie dog has different eyes than the bobcat. The prairie dog's eyes are here, and they actually face off to the side. So I'll demonstrate here again with the buttons. A prairie dog's eyes are actually shaped like this, and they face to the side, different than a bobcat. Well, this gives the prairie dog good peripheral vision. So your periphery is what's around you in this direction. So the prairie dog can see really well around like this. So I want you to put your hand behind your shoulder like this, okay? And kind of move your hand. You know it's there, but you can't see it, right? We call that a blind spot. And we have that blind spot because our eyes are facing forward, like a bobcat's. A prairie dog doesn't have that blind spot. A prairie dog will be able to see her own hand behind her shoulder like this. This gives her an advantage. When the bobcat comes up behind her, the prairie dog will be able to see the bobcat in time and run away. So that's an adaptation that gives a prairie dog an advantage. And let's look at another animal really quick. Now, which direction do these eyes face? Well, if you look carefully, here are the eyes. They're facing off to the side. This is also another prey animal. This is a deer. And she has the advantage of side-facing eyes, just like the prairie dog, to be able to see predators coming from behind her shoulder more quickly and more easily. We call that a pattern, right? By noting that many prey animals have side-facing eyes, we've noticed a pattern of similarities. Speaking of patterns, we've already established that if an animal has large auditory bullae or sound pockets, that means they have really excellent hearing, like this bobcat. Well, if we look at this prairie dog again, you can see right down here the auditory bullae or sound pockets. And they're very round, and even though the skull is small, the sound pockets themselves are quite large in comparison to the size of the skull. They're very visible. It's obvious that they're there, not like the bear, if you recall. That's because prairie dogs have an excellent sense of hearing. They depend on their sense of hearing because they depend on families and friends, on their family and friends in the grassland to warn them if there are predators nearby. They let out alarm calls. And grasslands can be very windy, so you need to have an excellent sense of hearing in order to hear the alarm calls of your friends and family. And that's why prairie dogs have these big sound pockets, these big auditory bullae. You can use patterns to make conclusions about animal skulls, to make guesses about adaptations on those skulls, to make guesses about how the animals interact with each other, like predators and prey, or how the animals interact with their environment, like having a great sense of smell for finding food. Skulls can be kind of spooky at first, but the more you explore them, the more you'll discover. Today, we talked about smell, sight, and hearing in wild animals. When you spend time outside, how can you use your senses to explore nature?
Hey, Mariana.
Hey, John.
Hey, Mariana, what are you doing?
I'm just exploring, trying to smell the flowers and listen for the birds and see if I can see anything.
Cool.
Yeah, it's a great way to explore. Try smelling with your nose, listening with your ears, and looking with your eyes. Bring a friend, explore together, and talk about your observations.